3 million years into deep space, the sci-fi podcast, Stories Out of Time and Space. Its hosts, Scott Weatherly, the only Brit to have never seen an episode of Gogglebox, and his podmate, Julian Darius, an American who is actually fun to be around. Together, they are taking on the epic challenge of reviewing all episodes of Red Dwarf. It won't change the world, but it's still a better contribution than anything from Donald Trump. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Stories Out of Time and Space. This is a bonus episode. This is sort of a between-season special that we're doing. We're taking a couple of episodes to focus in on something that's both dear to my heart and to Julian's. But before we get into that, Julian, how are you doing?
I'm doing all right. How are you, Scott?
I'm not too bad. I've said though, it's a bit cold outside. There's no kind of atmosphere, and I'm all alone. And if you can't guess from what we're going to be talking about, we are going to be getting deep on Red Dwarf. That's the British sci-fi sitcom that started in 1988. Well, really, I suppose, like, Julian, before we get into it, so what, Red Dwarf, it's been around, obviously, since the 80s. It's almost been, 30-plus years now. So how did you come across this, especially as an American? It's sort of, the other side of the pond, this dinky sort of British sitcom. How did you find it?
Well, I've found it on PBS, which is our public broadcasting system, sort of the American equivalent of BBC. And it would at night play, I mean, I still love PBS, but it would at night play a few British reruns. And, you know, I was, I don't know how old I was, maybe preteen, early teenager. And I would sort of stay up most of the night. I had a room in the basement by myself, and I could kind of hide out. I could watch TV late at night, and I could read. I read tons of stuff. I can't believe how much I read. And I would watch, like, all these old shows on rerun late at night, that I would discover all these Norman Lear shows. And I would watch PBS. And at PBS at night, I think it was like Saturdays, would play, I would just be watching it, and all of a sudden, like, you know, Doctor Who would come on, and then after Doctor Who was Red Dwarf. And so, I mean, my initial impression, I mean, first of all, you have to understand that I had no idea when any of this stuff was made, right? So, to my mind, like, I knew there, it was always, the Fourth Doctor stuff. And to my mind, I knew that, like, Doctor Who had been around for a long time, but I had no idea if there were 20 Red Dwarf episodes or 200. And I had no idea if they were, like, I just assumed they were really old, or at least several years old. I had no idea how small a series was compared to America. Yeah. But more than anything, these were Doctor Who was sort of... I'm more into Doctor Who now than I was then. I mean, what I remember was just seeing, a guy run down a corridor and thinking, like, this idiot with a scarf on his neck is supposed to be an alien, and it's the same corridor over and over. And, I'd watch it, but I wouldn't get into it. And then Red Dwarf would come on, and I'd think, what the hell am I watching? Yeah. And it really felt to me like they were broadcasts from a parallel universe. Like, they were in English. I could understand them, but they're filled with words that I didn't understand. They're filled with references that I did not understand. And I didn't have a framework for, like, really comedy sci-fi that was this. Like, I knew about Hitchhikers. I had maybe read Hitchhikers, but I didn't. I mean, this was something really aggressively, aggressively strange, aggressively... bizarre. And it just seemed to me like my television was picking up signals from, like, a parallel Earth where they spoke a little differently and the shows were really weird.
Yeah, I can imagine sort of, as you say, some of the references in this, there's even some, because this obviously came out, started in 1988, there are references in this that even I'm like, yeah, I'm not sure what that is. It's of its time, and I've got no clue who they are referencing at that point.
Yeah, it's fascinating to sort of see that it sort of, you know, it snuck its way over there. Because for me, I mean, over here it played on a Friday evening, I think like in between 8 and 9 o'clock, and it was part of that sort of Friday night comedy thing. I just remember this thing being on, and they would do reruns and other things, but this was sort of on the BBC Two, and there was other programs like Bottom and a couple of other comedy shows. But I would finish, sort of, I remember finishing Scouts. I was in with the Cubs or Scouts. And just racing home straight after that to get home in time to see, to get home to Red Dwarf. And, you know, the music, just if you could, the opening music to this in particular, of the later season, sort of from season sort of three onwards, is just so iconic to me that just the moment I hear it, it sort of takes me back. Like, it's one of those nostalgia switches that the moment it clicks in, I'm back there and I'm like, oh my God, I'm a kid and I love this show. Just sort of like, you get all the feels. And for the same reason, because it's sort of like it was mine. I mean, I was raised on sitcoms. You know, they're almost like there's a British tradition for sitcoms. I mean, I know there's American ones and I've seen them, but in Britain there seems to be that there's like a working class sitcom tradition. Do you know what I mean? So way back into sort of the '60s and seventies, everything from sort of Alf Garnett and Till Death Do Us Part and Porridge, which was a prison set one, and The Good Life and Only Fools and Horses, and I could go on and on. There's all these sort of sitcoms, and they're all sort of like about this sort of working class, but they were my parents' sitcoms, and I love them and I enjoy them. But Red Dwarf was mine because I remember my parents, as you say, it's aggressively strange. My parents were like, what are you watching? What is this weird show? What is it? And I'm like, shut up, it's mine. Leave me alone. I just loved it. And, yeah, like you say, it's just sort of, even here, it was never intended to be a success, I think is the best way of putting it. So the BBC sort of put it on BBC Two, and it was never meant to be a success. They were like, it's an idea, we'll try it, see what happens with it. And when sort of you get sort of by the end of season two, they're like, oh, wow, no, like people are really paying attention to this show. We should give some more money to it. So yeah, it's sort of like it was one of those, it's like the little sitcom that could really, and seems to have sort of survived for 30 years in different iterations, and where others have sort of died and fallen by the wayside. So it's always been there for me.
Yeah, I really dig what you're saying, especially about like how that theme song from three onward really hits you. I'm the same way, and I hate titles that have clips, right? I mean, that is so lowbrow and terrible. But you know, when I get to that in Red Dwarf, I'm like, oh, these are all the clips from the show I'm gonna see this season, you know.
Yes.
And I'm so excited, and I totally have an exception for Dwarf. The other thing is, for me, the end credits meant so much, that sort of that song. And I remember I had seen several episodes before I could understand the lyrics of the end credits. Yeah. And I remember as I understood them, I thought, you know, like I want to lie shipwrecked and comatose. I thought, you know, this is some like crazy stuff. Like, I mean, I hadn't, you know, I eventually I went to college and, you know, did every drug I could get my hands on. But, you know, I was like, you know, 13 going like, who'd want to lie shipwrecked and comatose? Like, this is so aggressively weird and wonderful. And that sounds blissful at the same time that it sounds, you know, insane. I just love that energy.
Well, that's the thing. And one of the things that sort of, you know, we've sort of said it about other shows and other films during the season, of that idea of like, you're either on the train with it or you're not. You know, and those things that don't care. And we sort of said about films like Christopher Nolan films, sort of like, especially like Memento or something, like, you're either onto it or you're not, you know, and that's where the film's at. But that's like it with Red Dwarf. Like, this film's, this program, on the surface, it's almost like it starts out as an odd couple thing. And we'll get to the premise in a minute. It starts out as an odd couple thing. You know, it's the sort of two people that don't really like each other, trapped in a scenario where they cannot avoid each other. And then they sort of throw other elements in. But then you sort of like, when you dig into it a bit more, you start to realise that, oh, no, they've got a whole commentary on religion and, you know, the forming of religions around false information, around, you know, the existence of other intelligent life forms in space. And you know, the pursuit of that. They deal with sort of dealing with your own death and having to sort of, like, you know, to live in an incorporeal way as just a sort of an intelligence. And then they deal with, like, slavery when you finally get Crichton, and this thing of having to have a purpose and in servitude. And you start to dig into it and you're like, oh, man, this is deep in a really, really, like, weird way of sort of being funny and amazing. But it's dealing with some really odd. I mean, there's an episode we may or may not get into called Camille that starts to deal with interspecies relationships. And, like,
yes.
When I was a kid watching this stuff, I'm like, this is funny and it's weird. She's a blobby alien. And now I'm like, oh, it's really touching that Crichton, like, sacrifices his own, like, his feelings for the betterment of somebody else. You're like, wow, this is, I shouldn't be feeling this about a sitcom that's got a defective android in it. Like, I can't believe how much sort of, like, Rob Grant and Doug Naylor sort of, like, slipped into this sitcom and no one seems to have noticed, or the BBC executives never seem to notice.
Yeah, I have a weird relationship to comedy. I find that I laugh more at Red Dwarf than at most sitcoms, which usually don't make me laugh at all. And I'm funny in person, but there's something about comedy that, you know, I usually just, like, you anticipate the joke. Like, if I go to see stand-up comedy, I'll laugh, like, 20 seconds before everyone else because I see what's being set up and I'm thinking, oh, that's clever. And then I laugh and everybody thinks I'm insane. And then 20 seconds later, everybody laughs. And it's not that I'm brilliant or something, but it's like, I see what's being done here. I see the mechanism, and I, you know, it kind of ruins the humor for me a lot of times. But I laugh at Red Dwarf. But I think, you know, what really sold me on it, besides these sort of, like, aggressive weirdness, and of course, you know, the British accents, the way it was coded for race, you know, that clearly, yeah, like, Lister was something different. I didn't know how to locate that within British society, but I knew that, like, a working class thing is being done here. You know, an ethnic thing is being done here. I don't have those reference points, but I kind of can see what's being done. But then it was, above all, it was the fact that it's just a good sci-fi show. And there are so many episodes that if you strip the humor out, it would still be a really good show. Like, you could easily adapt half of these episodes into really good Star Trek episodes, right?
Yeah. Yeah. That's one of the things that's great. It's like, and, you know, we'll get to the premise in a minute so we can explain to those who have never seen it. But one of the things that, like, Rob Grant and Doug Naylor were really keen on when they were setting this up was, like, the sci-fi should be serious. Like, that's never the source of comedy. Like, the characters and everything and the situation can be, but the sci-fi premise has got to remain maybe not pure, but, you know, it's got to be a pure, proper sci-fi concept, you know, and that comes through. Like, you know, some of the things they talk about and they use, like you say, you could, well, and they have done, like, there's a whole parallel universe concept. They go, you know, they have sort of the amount of times they travel in time in these, I'd forgotten about how many times they go through time yeah. in this, they use time travel in these first four series is incredible. And stuff like that. And, you know, it's yeah, you could, and I think they have. I mean, I won't lie; they do sort of steal elements from things like Star Trek, and then sort of, sure, like, you know, play with it. You know, I mean, there's episodes, I think there's in season four called Meltdown, where they go to a planet that's or filled with wax or androids of historical, you know, figures from historical Earth's history. Einstein, Gandhi, Hitler, Mussolini, all these people. And that just, to me, feels like an original series Star Trek episode. That's the kind of thing they would do. You know, we find an M-class planet filled with androids. Red Dwarf goes in a slightly different direction than I think Trek would have gone.
Oh, for sure. And yeah, I mean, watching that, I think, like, oh, like, you're that's one of the episodes that, like, most rips something off. And I think it's ripping off Westworld, right? Before the current HBO show. You know, and I can see that now. I don't know that I would have known that at the time. But it's still, it does feel very Trek. And it does go in this, you know, weird Red Dwarf direction that no other show would have gone. The other thing is there's this theme, especially rewatching it, there's this theme of other copies of ourselves, whether it's like due to time travel or parallel dimensions or whatever. Characters are always meeting additional duplicates of themselves. It's amazing how often this happens. And one of the themes that had always perplexed me as a kid was, you know, that I've always felt that one of the key ways of testing yourself is to say, would I like myself if I met myself, right? Like, there are so many people who you think, you know, you'd really hate yourself. You think this is all clever, but you would be so annoyed. And to kind of think of myself like, you know, my moody elements, those parts of myself that would probably really annoy myself. I think I'd love myself. I think I'd be like the cat and just say like, you know, oh, I want to have sex with myself. That sounds great. But then there'd be other times where I'd be like, oh, you know, this is, you are just a moody bastard, you know?
Yeah.
And those parts of myself that I wouldn't like, that's like a useful diagnostic tool to like zero in and say, I've got a problem here. Maybe I need to fix those things. And I always find those stories really interesting and perplexing.
Yeah. And there's a couple actually, when we'll get onto those actually, because I'm thinking of like Rimmer's interaction with himself is always fascinating because of all the characters, he's probably obviously the most broken. But let's quickly jump in with a quick overview of the premise, because even if the premise itself is loaded with sort of sci-fi elements and things worth talking about. So Red Dwarf is the name of the ship. It's a mining ship owned by the Jupiter Mining Corps. It's 6 miles long, 5 miles deep. No, 5 miles deep and 3 miles wide is what it's supposed to be. They're the dimensions, I think, that sort of I read. So this thing is huge. It's sort of staffed by these hundreds of people. And the idea is that it goes off into space and it literally is a mining ship. So it's loaded with mining materials, miners and crew for Red Dwarf. At the bottom of the totem pole of all of these people is a second level technician and a third level technician, Dave Lister, who's the lowest ranking person on the ship, and his superior or supervisor, third level technician, Arnold Judas Rimmer. They've basically got the lowliest maintenance jobs, you know, unclogging toilets and chicken soup dispensers. And so they get the sort of the crappy jobs. And Lister's only doing this for the money. For him, and this is actually an interesting one, because in the original series, his the reason for him signing up is never really fully disclosed. It's just sort of like he joined up and it was to bum around. He wanted to just go, you know, to just bum around in space, save up some money so that he could go back to Earth and set up his farm in Fiji.
Right.
Lister wants to go. Dave Lister wants to go home. He's been bumming around in space. He wants to go back with enough money to buy a farm in Fiji with a pig, some goats and a dog and raise horses. And he then wants to do it with the girl of his dreams, a woman he's met on the ship called Christine Kachansky, who's a navigation officer, who in the original iterations, so in the first sort of couple of seasons, has had minimal interactions with him. So she's always been this sort of like just out of reach fantasy for him, really. But the big key thing is Dave Lister and Arnold Rimmer do not get on. They despise each other. But the other thing is, of course, is that Dave Lister has snuck a cat on board that should have been quarantined, or if more importantly, should never have been on the ship in the first place. When it's identified that this cat is on board, the captain demands to know where this cat is. It turns out that the cat is called Frankenstein, is not a Frankenstein male, is a Frankenstein female, and is pregnant and is hidden away in the cargo decks. And when Dave Lister does not give up the cat, he gets put into stasis. He's going to stay in stasis for 6 months and be docked 6 months' pay. Whilst he's in stasis, Rimmer is tasked with fixing a drive plate on part of the engines. He does a poor job, and because of that, there's a radium or cadmium, I can't remember what the chemical is, but there's basically a massive radiation leak that kills everybody on the ship. And by everybody, I mean everybody. And so the ship's computer, which is a personality and a face called Holly, decides to keep Dave Lister in stasis for 3 million years until the radiation levels are down to a safe background level and he can be released out of stasis. The other thing as well to note is when the event happens, they are actually in the outskirts of our solar system, but for safety's sake and protocol, Holly directs the ship out into deep space. So he's been traveling into deep space for 3 million years. So they are 3 million years away from Earth. So when he comes out, he then asks, where's everybody? And as Holly says, they're dead, Dave. Dave, they're dead. Everybody's dead. So Dave Lister is now the last, possibly, you never actually clear, but he's the last human being alive in deep space. But not to be left alone and not to be sort of, you know, to be driven alone that way, but you'd be driven mad. So Holly brings back a crew member to keep him company, the person that he has had the most interaction with during his time on the ship, as a hologram. So Holly and the ship can sustain a single hologram. They bring back Rimmer, who else, to be his companion in this deep space. And that's sort of the initial premise, because it's the odd couple in space. But to really throw things up, of course, the cat, Frankenstein, had lots of kittens. Those kittens went on to breed. I have questions about that. But they were kept safe in the hold from all the radiation, and they evolved into a humanoid cat species. The majority of the cat species have jettisoned themselves off into space in search of Fushal, which we will get to. And the only ones that remained were the blind priest and the idiot. And the idiot is known as Cat, a preening, narcissistic, well-dressed Danny Junjules, or sort of just the cat, who joins them as... it's hard to say in the first seasons, as pet, as companion, as just sort of someone who's there. So that's the first couple of series, really. The first two series is Arnold Rimmer as a dead hologram, Dave Lister as the last human alive, a being that has evolved from the ship's cat, and a slightly senile, demented ship's computer in Holly. And from that point on, weirdness and comedy ensue. That's quite a long-winded review, but that's pretty much the premise.
And I think almost all of that, that's basically the first episode, right? Except in the first episode, we don't find out why there's only one cat. The cat does reference that they have a religion about Cloyster the Stupid, which is, you know, how they've remembered Lister. Somewhat absurdly that religion has recorded something for 3 million years. But it's still funny and clever. There are elements of this that are immediately apparent as a kind of like satire of Star Trek, right? You see the food dispenser, right? You know, this is the sort of food dispenser on Star Trek, and you know, Rimmer's fixing it. There's a Next Generation episode that's very beloved called Lower Decks that is focused on sort of the ensigns and the underlings of the show. Which Trek was always traditionally focused on, you know, the captains, and you ignored the red shirts. Obviously, that came years after Red Dwarf, and, you know, has become, you know, a major source of inspiration in Trek going forward. But Red Dwarf was doing it back in 88. These are the lowest of the low, right? The lowest people on the ship, literally.
Yeah, at one point in the first episode, they referenced, I think, that Lister says the only people that rank lower than him are the laboratory mice. So, yeah, they are literally the bottom of the pile. These are the working class dudes.
Well, I do have to say, I didn't, you know, it took me a while to realize that they were still in the solar system, even though it's a Jupiter mining thing. It does not do a good job of explaining in that first episode, oh yeah, we were still in the solar system and we just kept going. That's something that I missed, even having seen this several times, but that was clearer to me this time around. And I guess the only other thing of that setup is that the initial idea of the show is that they're sort of trying to get back to Earth, not knowing if it's even still there 3 million years yeah. later, or if humans are even around. And that very shortly, it becomes clear, I mean, and I think this is another important part of this premise, that there basically is no life in the universe except humans. I mean, it is a lifeless, sad, depressing, meaningless universe in which there is no God and there's no life except humans. And later on, you see other human-created life, you know, androids, genetically engineered life forms, but... I mean, it was part of the original premise that, no, we're not going to do androids, we're not going to do aliens. And as the series goes on, Rimmer is sort of, everything he sees, he thinks, oh, you know, I bet these are aliens. And it's a sort of running joke that he wants to believe. He's the X-Files, right? He wants to believe.
Yes, yeah. I think he needs to believe, doesn't he? Because I think, like you say, they keep sort of, it's sort of alluded to later on that he wants to find it. More advanced aliens, because they might be able to bring him back from the dead, like give him a body in some way, like a physical presence, because he is just literally a hologram. He's light generated. But I do like that. I mean, like say in the first season, the sort of the episode where they find the pod, and he's convinced it's aliens, and he's doing like a full on analysis of the pod. And it turns out later just to be a Red Dwarf garbage pod that's been jettisoned and been in space, and some of the letters have burnt off. And, you know, it's, yeah, his desperation for these things and obsession is quite sad, really, to be honest.
Yeah. Well, and it's also tied to religion. I mean, when they have the first discussion of that, it's explicitly, you know, sort of Rimmer saying, this can't be a meaningless universe. And Lister says, oh, well, you know, you believe in God then. And Rimmer says, oh, don't be ridiculous. You know, I mean, they're both atheists, right?
Yeah.
Like Trek, it's an atheistic future, but it's much more wears it on its sleeve. You know, and Rimmer said, don't be ridiculous, but I do believe in aliens. And there is this way in which, you know, I feel like that sort of satires the alien abduction people, you know, the people who believe like we're being visited, and what they believe is irrational in many cases, but it is, they would say, well, this is science based, it's not a faith, but those aliens are going to reveal themselves to us and like aid our civilization or whatever, you know. Obviously different people believe different things, but
well, no, yeah, it's true. I mean, you know, like I say, he attributes, and they play it for laughs, because he attributes so much to aliens. Like say that at one point they joke that that time we used up all that toilet paper, you thought that was aliens. Well, we didn't use it. Who did? And it's like, aliens, what were they doing with that much toilet paper? I don't know. They're alien. Alien things. They could be doing alien things with it.
Well, see, that explains all the Marvel movies, right? Because alien technology is just so advanced. It's magic. And hey, they're aliens. They're motivated by whatever. You know, the other thing is, you know, I have to come back to like how bizarre and alien all of this was to me. You know, to me, the term smeghead was, you know, which they use, was no different than hearing git, sod, or bog roll. I mean, I had to figure out like, you know, I had to figure out from context what any of this stuff meant. My only reference point was like reading early issues of Hellblazer, you know. I mean, I had no other source for understanding any of these terms.
Well, I think it's funny because a lot of it is just like you say, Englishisms or Britishisms. Git is a well-known and well-used term to describe people. But yeah, this thing. I think the thing is, again, they wanted to use, you know, I think from Rob Grant and Doug Naylor's position, they were like, well, you know, like I say, these are just technicians. These are sort of quite sort of like blue-collar guys, and they would be sort of talking in this way, but we can't swear. So we almost need to create up some slang and, you know, jargon for them to use. So there's a few things they throw in, and some land and some don't. So smeghead is obviously, you know, the one that seems to have landed the most, and is so synonymous with Red Dwarf. But throughout it, like Rimmer, there's an episode where Rimmer uses the word goit about 5 times. He's just like, they're really trying to sort of see what else lands. And that one doesn't seem to come back much. But yeah, it's very much, you know, full of these Englishisms. when you say that, you know, you're a fan of it, it's like, I'm assuming it must have come with subtitles at some point, because some of these, like you say, there's whole rants or monologues, and you're like, yeah, that wouldn't translate much outside of, you know, outside of the British Isles, really.
Yeah, I mean, I've never watched it with subtitles. I mean, like I said, there were references that I wouldn't get. I mean, obviously class means something different in Britain than it does in America. We have a different system. I could tell that something's going on there with Lister. The other thing is, I mean, Lister is a slob, and, yeah. 12-year-old me is like, what the hell is a vindaloo? I went on to, Indian is one of my two favorite cuisines, and actually I quite love vindaloo. I can't tell how many times before I got into vindaloo, I was into Rogan Josh because there was there's a Vertigo prestige thing. So everything I learned at my intro to Indian food was all pop culture, right? But I had no idea what is this vindaloo he keeps spilling. I had no idea what it was.
Well, that's a good point about this is sort of like, as you go through this sort of Lister is, it's an interesting character, but they've sort of made sure that none of the characters in this are like wholly aspirational. Like, even Lister, who is probably the most moral and sort of, he's the most grounded and down to earth and that sort of thing. Like, yeah, but he's still not, I'm happy to watch him and I find him funny, but like, you don't want to be him. You'd probably be all right as his mate, sort of thing. But even then, you'd be like, Dave, I can't go out every night. Like, I've got to stay in and do something else.
Also, he's smelly, right? I mean, his socks, and everything are a constant source of humor. I mean, who wants to be out with their friend and their friend has like 20 stains on their shirt, right? At some point, it's not fun.
That's it. So that's it. And that's why I think it's quite brave. And that's sort of in that sentiment of like, he is, from a personality point of view, like he probably would be a lot of fun. But like, yeah, you don't want to be Dave Lister. Like, none of the characters in this are sort of like, aspirational. That's fair. Dave has no aspirations at all, really. And so, like you say, it's interesting that they've sort of gone for that. And that seems like to me that always feels like a British thing. Like, whenever I find that sort of, we'll get onto the American attempts at this, whether in this episode or the future one, but why it's so different with Americans, there's always seems to be a need to have sort of a central character, or at least a character that's aspirational or good and the good looking one or whatever. And you have that, but within British sitcoms, we don't want to. We almost want to hate them. Like if you look at some of the most successful British sitcoms, aside from Red Dwarf, like they're never about good people. Like Fawlty Towers is one of those things that sort of is lauded. So but like Basil Fawlty, John Cleese Basil Fawlty, is horrible, like a terrible person. Blackadder, one of the most successful and loved British comedies, like. Blackadder is a terrible person.
I love Blackadder, yeah.
That's it. They are brilliantly written. They're brilliantly acted. They're fantastic. But, like, they're never nice people. Like, even some of the softer ones, there's a series of from the 70s, and one of my favourites is, like, Porridge. It's about a couple of convicts in prison. Now, that's not in itself a bad thing, but it's the way they play the system throughout it, and the general consensus of that series is don't let the bastards grind you down. It's just about surviving in prison. And you're just like, yeah, this is cynical. all the way through to like, yes, minister and yes, prime minister, where there's entire seasons about how inept and bad the government is. And we're just laughing away at it. It's bizarre but it's innately British. That just seems to be our comedy seems to focus on. We either like the underdog, or horrible people.
We like parodies of the government. I mean, I think too much over here, because the parodies aren't very apt. They're usually just sort of government's inept. But, I think about Philip K. Dick. all of his novels are filled with horrible people, right? I mean, people that are just filled with petty thoughts. And that's partly why they're so relatable. I mean, even if they don't act petty, they have that thought, and the novel what gives voice to that thought. And then they get adapted by Hollywood, and it's like, that character has been turned into Tom Cruise with coiffured hair and, you know, that's not the same guy. But yeah, there's something very, you know, if not American, certainly Hollywood about that.
Yeah, and that's it. I mean, if you take, talk about the first couple of seasons, those characters, Dave Lister, Arnold Rimmer, and the cat, and even Holly to an extent, like, you know, as the, mm-hmm. as the ship's computer, like, you know, he has a personality, and they've made him sort of like, you know, he's got an IQ of 6,000, but they've obviously chosen like Norman Lovett. With his sort of northern accent for a reason, because it sort of feels and he's playing him a bit dim, you know. He says, oh, I've got an IQ of 6,000. It's not that much. It's the same as sort of 6,000 PE teachers. And it's there's always that downside to it, isn't there? So it's sort of like you say, Dave is slovenly and aspirations, like, you know, he sounds like he should be good fun on a night out, but probably not that often. But he has a moral center, you know. He has that morality of things that he always wants to try and do the right thing. So he's sort of like that underdog. He is the British underdog that you sort of want to support, and so I do want you to do well because I do want to see you to succeed. And then his contrast, obviously, is Rimmer, who is that sort of comes from a middle class background, but has clearly failed and blames everybody else for it. And he's just angry at the world and bitter with the world, and wants to sort of play that sort of role. You know, he aspires to be that sort of military leader. Yet you wouldn't want to trust him with a gun, never mind you know, an army. But there are still times every now and then when you do sort of feel for Rimmer.
Yes.
Like, yeah, they never ever sort of have him as just being this one note sort of horrible person. The more you learn about his history, the more you're like, oh man, this guy is screwed up for a reason.
Yeah, that's very true. You know, I sort of see him as sort of wannabe upper class, right? Like, I mean, mm-hmm. as it goes on, you find out that he, you know, like his brothers were sent to boarding school and he wasn't. So, there's some money or resources there that Lister didn't have, but Rimmer wants to work within the system, and he has the personality of a feckless toady, and, you know, Lister has no interest. I mean, he's, you know, a stoner, you know, who just wants to have fun and make some money and, you know, retire to Fiji with a beautiful woman.
Yeah, and that's it. And that's so to me, sort of when I was a kid, you know, Lister was the character I enjoyed and I rooted for. And I still liked him. I still like him. But as I've got older and watching out, I find Rimmer more interesting as a character. Mm-hmm. Not to say I like him. Like, I wouldn't want to spend time with him or be him. But I do find him as a sort of an interesting character because his psyche is... you know, his mental state is it's so scary. You know, I mean, we'll go through some of the episodes in a bit, but in series two, there's the episode Better Than Life, mm-hmm. where they have the opportunity to do a sort of a virtual reality game that when you sort of plug yourself into it, you are literally able to do anything better than life. Like, you know, it will give you everything you want, all your whims, all those regrets that you may have had, you can rectify and do all this other stuff, and you can lead that sort of life. The problem with it is, of course, that you could then, you know, it's actually sort of, it's alluded to, but it's never, it's sort of more expressed in the novels, which again, we'll talk about somewhat, that once you're in it, it's difficult to get out of it. Unless you're Rimmer. Because, you know, for some reason, Rimmer's turns on him, and where sort of Lister and the cat are sort of fulfilling all these fantasies and doing all this, having a great time, Lister gets, he finds the woman of his dreams, he marries this woman, and then within 3 hours he's got 6 kids and a mortgage, and then within a couple of hours later the tax man's after him, and all this other, and it just builds and builds, and you're just like, he's like, my brain like won't let him, he can't believe that he can succeed or do well. For all of his drive and need to be accepted and to be done to do well, it won't accept it. His brain won't let him, mm-hmm. because he's so sort of, his self-loathing is so sort of so strong.
Yeah, I mean, he hates himself, but I think he evolves as the show goes on. I mean, you know, especially once you hit like series three, he's still the same guy, but he's a lot more competent in ways that he wouldn't have been earlier on. And I think that he does become more sympathetic. I think that, you know, he sort of starts as the toady who, you know, enforces the rules in a sort of draconian way. But, you know, there is something very American about him in the sense that he feels as if his failure to achieve sort of class status, or at least success within this military structure, is ultimately must be the response of somebody else. Although his inner feeling beyond that is really, I'm terrible and I failed because I'm a miserable, horrible person. And he hates himself. And I think that, you know, as an American, I had no idea who to root for or anything. These were all just totally alien characters to me. But there is something about, you know, in my country, the sort of myth of meritocracy, right? That if you haven't achieved this, I mean, which, as far as I know, the Brits have no illusions of meritocracy within their class system. But, you know, in America, if you haven't achieved that status, which obviously Rimmer's brothers did and was sort of expected, he internalizes it that, you know, somehow I failed. I've made some bad choices. And the truth is, we all make bad choices. We all could be petty and stupid. But he has sort of, you know, and I'm not saying he's a good person, but I mean, he has internalized those failures as the explanation. And so his options are to blame somebody else, right? Or to say, I'm terrible. And I do see people, I mean, you know, I'm, you know, 43 as I record this. You know, by the time you're that age, you kind of know whether you're, you know, going to be a billionaire or not, you know? Yeah. And if the answer is no, you know, or, you know, you have friends who are comfortably more affluent than you, the question sort of comes out, well, why haven't I? And it's very easy to kind of get bitter and look at, you know, opportunities that weren't given to you that somebody else had. So, I mean, there is a way in which I understand that in a particularly American way.
Yeah, and I like the idea of that sort of thing of, as you say, sort of having to internalize it. Within the British classing, I think there is that. There is this sort of, as Rimmer puts it, like up the ziggurat, lickety split, you know, this idea of sort of like self, you can get yourself, you can sort of like work your way up if you want to, you know, if you, if you try hard enough and you fit in with that next level of thing, like, you know, sort of, you can do it. You can jump up a class, at least one class, you know, working class to middle class or whatever. Like, if you really wanted it, you could do it. And the thing I say, the thing with the contrast is, like, say, Dave Lister's got no intention and no desire to do that. If anything, in a later episode, he actually refers to himself as a class traitor because he went to a wine bar. So he's sort of like, you know, he's very much like a working class sort of like, you know, dude. He wants to sort of protect it, that sort of like thing. That he almost carries it almost as a badge of honor. Well, where Rimmer is, that sort of, like you say, he wants to get up to that next level. And more than any other character, which is interesting as I watch it back on this, more than any other characters, like Lister, you know, wants to get back to Earth and he wants to see humans, and he gets that in several sort of roundabout ways. But Rimmer actually gets the opportunity to achieve the things he wants more than, you know, on a number of occasions, and just blows it, like, again and again, and keeps sort of like, you know, I don't know, there's just this sort of thing of him. I mean, we go to the first episode, but the episode Balance of Power, where, you know, he is so stuck in that rigid system, as you said, working within the system, he's trying to get up through the navigation channels. He wants to become an officer. He wants to take the officer exam or the navigation, astro navigation exam. And he keeps failing it like 14 times. I think he sort of failed it. But Lister decides that, well, I can actually be your superior. But I don't have to get the I don't have to get that route. I can just go and learn to be a chef. So he goes to take the chef's exam, and Lister, Rimmer even says to him, like, well, but you don't want to be a chef. He's like, no, you're right, I don't. But I can be your superior. And because you are so stuck in that ridiculous notion, even now that we're the only two sort of sentient human beings in the universe, in that system, you'll do as I tell you, which is lunacy, but it'll make you do what I want you to do. And that to me is sort of really tragic in many ways, that he can't look outside himself. I mean, the fact of the matter is that even after everyone has died and, you eventually sort of learn sort of like, you know, to sort of see that it's his fault when he feels responsible for that. But the fact of the matter is that he still wears his uniform as a hologram. For the first two series, at least, like, he is still tied to the world before the disaster, and the structures and the order and everything that goes with it. And you sort of look at yourself and you're 3 million years into deep space. Like, you're the only two sentient human beings, you know, within at least 3 million years. Like, you don't have to keep adhering to the Jupiter Mining Corps' rules and regulations.
Very true. I mean, on the other hand, there's something about Lister that irritates me too, and it's not just his messiness. I mean, I like that he's relaxed, right? I mean, obviously, he's less neurotic and just mad than Rimmer is.
Yeah,
but he doesn't have any sort of aspiration. Like, as messed up as Rimmer's aspiration is, it's just to ascend this stupid system that doesn't respect him. There's something deeply pathetic about that. But, you know, I would think, like, okay, well, I'm alone. I'm out in space 3 million years away from Earth. We may well be the last humans. This sucks. Maybe I'll start to write. Maybe I'll start to do something. Maybe I'll, you know, I mean, nobody ever decides to do anything. Lister just wants to drink and eat curry. You know, and there's something, you know, there's something I can't relate to about that, or that I find sort of oddly, you know, despicable in a way that Rimmer isn't.
No, it's true. It's weird because you're right. Because, you know, he is, you know, Rimmer's a hologram, whatever. And so he is the last. Most likely that, I mean, at least if it's 3 million years into the future, like, you know, we'd have evolved in some way. So he's the only representation of, I think it's supposed to be sort of 21st, 22nd century humans. And there's no sort of like existential crisis about that from Lister. There's no sort of like, yeah, Christ, I could be the last, I literally could be the last human. And then actually that also means that potentially then Red Dwarf as a ship could then in TOS also actually be the last representation of the human race. So all the not, because all the knowledge, all the, there could be books on there that, you know, I mean, this thing's 6 miles long and 5 miles wide, whatever. So it's a huge ship. So there's all kinds of stuff on there. Everything from, you know, like you say, the lowest sort of like form of pulp entertainment that's probably going to be on there. You know, like when they remake Casablanca, all the way through to copies of Shakespeare and other things that are going to be on that ship. Like, that is it's a representation of the human race. And at no point does he sort of go, yeah, this could actually be really important and we should sort of look to maintain and sustain this. Nope. Yeah. I'm just going to have a few tinnies and like you say, drink, have a curry. Yeah. Like you say, so he isn't aspirational in sort of like, you know, so he's irresponsible, I think is a way to describe it.
Yeah, and there's something, you know, I relate to both of them in different ways. But, you know, I think that, like, looking at that first episode, and I did not watch them in order. I mean, I watched whatever I got. But looking at that first episode, you know, I don't like really that odd couple dynamic. I find really, like, the first 20 minutes of that first episode essentially not funny. And not very interesting. And then all of a sudden everybody's dead. And it's like, you know, the whole show just takes a left turn. And then within the next 10 minutes or 8 minutes, everything hits. Everything is brilliant. Everything is surprising. And, you know, you were talking about these two characters, and I love the just sheer wackiness, the sheer meaninglessness of this, that the human race is left with this guy who's got no aspiration, a hologram of the guy he hates the most, who's, you know, a toady, you know, this cat, this computer. None of this means anything. It's and it's 3 million years later, and we're alone in a meaningless universe. Oh well, let's get on with it. You know, I just find this premise so delightful, and I find that left turn so delightful.
Well, and that's it, because it is. It's sort of if I suppose, you know, when you if this had been a released today as a you know, an opening premise. And you to keep this quiet, you know, and you didn't really know what the eventual premise was going to be, and you watch this from the start, you would, you'd be like, oh, it's going to be a workplace, it's The Office in space, you know,
right?
That's what you'd be. And then, like you say, but if you take The Office and then kill everybody off apart from two characters, you're like, oh, no, The Office just became The Walking Dead. Oh, that's a real, that's a bit different. And it does, and I like the fact that it does that, and it continues to do those things though, because it does, it keeps taking those leaps and doing those things that you're a bit like, that's interesting. You know, I wouldn't think to do that. I mean, like you say, the first episode, the leap from the first to the second episode is that's the first time when they sort of go, oh no, we're going to go full bore, and you better keep up, because you know we're going to introduce things that may or may not land. But we're going to go full sci-fi on this. And that's what I respect about it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, the first episode is titled The End, right? How transgressive. Your first episode is The End. And, you know, again, I mean, if I were watching this straight, I started with the first episode, I would think, okay, nothing's really going on here. But more than that, the jokes aren't landing. That odd couple dynamic isn't really funny yet to me. But then everything goes crazy and you have this, you know, this brilliantly absurd sort of finale to it. And I love that episode. But then the next episode is absolutely insane, where you have, you know, it's called Future Echoes, and you have all of these visions of the future and sort of predicting. Obviously, they didn't know if the show was going to be on for 5 years, let alone 171. But this seems so insanely aggressive and ambitious to, in your second episode, jump to this sci-fi premise and show your characters where they're going to go, in theory, right? That seems so out of the box and crazy.
Well, it's funny because the second episode is caused so many issues with fan theory and all this other stuff, because you say so that the concept is that, like you say, they've reached, because Hotley's also been accelerating for a certain amount of time, and they're about to reach and break light speed, so all of his runtime is basically coming to being spent navigating whilst he slows the ship down. And so what happens as they break light, they, like you say, they start to see flashes of the future, and it starts a little slow, you know, like say it's a couple of minutes in front and this and that. But like you say, it then ends, or it gets to, towards it. You see an old Lister in the bunk, sort of like predict, you know, giving sort of information about the distant future, like having sons. He's obviously going to live to old age. He's got a robot arm, you know, even at that age, at like 100, he's meant to be like 100 and something. That, you know, he plays a joke on Rimmer from the future. He's like, Rimmer, do you want to know what happens to you? Come closer. Come closer, and then disappears, and you're sort of like, "That's, I love that." But yeah, it's really ambitious to sort of say, by episode two, oh yeah, by the way, we're going to show you this that is never really going to play into continuity at all, but we're going to show it you anyway.
Yeah, they sort of play with it here and there, but you know, I'm still a sucker for it.
It's great.
Well, the other thing is, you know, we've talked about time travel, you know, on multiple episodes, and it's not consistent within this show either, obviously. but episode two is a brilliant example of that deterministic version of time travel, where, you know, which is so smart, right? So, you know, Rimmer has seen Lister die. And, you know, we're just like, okay, the second episode, it's like, I've seen you die as a character. One of the two characters, right? The two main ones. And, you know, he says, oh, you were wearing a hat. So, you know, so Lister takes off his hat and says, I'll never wear it, you know. You know, and he sees the cat run down the hall missing a tooth. So he runs, he says, oh, how could this happen? He runs to prevent the cat from biting his robot fish that he's seen the cat eyeing. But in the struggle to prevent him from biting the fish, the cat hits the wall and loses a tooth. So he's caused exactly what he tried to prevent. And this is a perfect example of how that kind of determinism works. But it's presented so fast. It doesn't tell you, oh, by the way, this is brilliant. Those brilliant sci-fi elements are just in the background of this accelerated fun stuff.
Yeah, and that's why I think, like you say, the writing's so good. And it's that thing of like that at the opening episode, they're getting the sort of the concept out of the way. You know, like, okay, here's the characters, here's the concept, boom, right, we're off to the races. Because Future Echoes, it really does play into that idea, doesn't it, of sort of like you say, the determinist future, and they stick with it for the first two seasons. They really do try and stick with it, because you eventually learn that who the person Rimmer saw being blown up in the drive room wasn't Lister, it was actually one of his sons. And if the episode ends, this is episode two, like you say, the episode ends with a future echo of Dave Lister holding two children. And he says, you know, basically, hello, everybody. Meet your sons, Dave. This is Jim and this is Bexley. And that's it. That's the end of the episode. And you're just like, he says, how are you going to get two sons on this? How are you going to have two children on this ship without any women? He's like, I don't know, but it's going to be a lot of fun finding out. And you're thinking, yeah, they're setting up some sort of conclusion down the line on this one. They must be. But yeah, like episode two, they sort of really threw you in the deep end.
Well, and I love that so much. I mean, it's sort of like that left turn that first episode takes is followed through. And it's like, you know, episode two tells you, oh, it's going to be all left turns from here on out. You know, get used to it. Strap in, because this is what we're doing. And, you know, I often think, I think it was true of the Davies Who as well, that some of the best stuff, the best shows, especially that pilot is important, but that second episode, like once you set up the premise, can you deliver a second episode that just feels like a gut punch, that just, you know, really shows what you can do and is the sort of manifesto of, all right, now we've done the hard work of laying all the groundwork. You get it already. Here's an example of what we can do in that second episode. And this just hits it out of the park.
And I think, again, you know, from a storyboard, and that's what they keep doing. Like, they keep throwing concepts at you that, like you say, you end up sort of questioning. I mean, you know, the one for me is that episode four of the season is Waiting for God.
Oh, yeah.
That you start to learn, and it goes, it throws this into religion. And we haven't really talked about the cat, because as a character, there's not much to the cat. You know, he is literally the personification of what a feline cat would be as a person. You know, I love the fact that he has a spray that he goes around. He's like, this is man, and this is man, and this is man. That, not that bit, that's not man. But all this is man. Like, Danny John Jules pays him to perfection. Like, there's not much to him as a character, but, like, the enthusiasm and the grace and everything that Danny John Jules brings is perfect. But when you start to learn about the cat species, and you realize, I say, that they've based their sort of existence around this of Lister or Cloyster the Stupid, and you learn the religion and stuff, and it starts to poke fun at, like, you know, the religious setups and religious war and all this other stuff. you know, you basically find that for millions of years they've been based on this thing, and his writings around wanting to set up like a fast food stand in Fiji.
Yeah,
you know, that's the whole concept is the donut and the sausage. So they have like the sacred donut hat, and that he carries the sausage. And you know, the two, there was a war. There was a religious war between two factions, and you're thinking, oh my god, this is, you know, it's all held all within the confines of this massive ship over thousands of years, over the fact that some believed that the hats were going to be blue, and some thought they were going to be green or yellow, and or red, whatever. And even Dave says, "Wow, that's ridiculous. They were going to be green." And
right. Like,
the ridiculousness of like that battle, and that's it. Like going to war over sort of like these writings that are millions of years old, which actually mean nothing, you know, really, in a sort of in this universe at least, is so well done.
Yeah.
But I love the fact that, and this is one of the reasons I like Dave Lister as a character, is when towards the end of the episode, they follow the cat, or Dave follows the cat into the ducts. And it's clear that the cat has got no real care for religion, but you find the old priest. And
this is the only other surviving cat, right? They've all wiped themselves out in religious wars. And here's this old cat priest who's blind.
Yeah. And he's actually saying, Cloyster, I let you down. I lost my faith. And Dave Lister could have said, like, yeah, you're right. This is ridiculous. Like, you know, there is no Fushel. It's Fiji. It's on Earth. And, you know, you wasted your time on this. Well, he doesn't do that. He says, no, you did great. And, you know, thank you for sort of carrying on. And, you know, you'll find your place in the great beyond and this other stuff. And, like, he takes the time to sort of comfort this old person before he dies. You know, gives him, this priest, the miracle before he dies and stuff. And it's like, you realize that sort of, he's never going to be, he's never going to be a great human being per se, but he's actually a good person. And that's again, like the writing of all this, it's like, it takes jab after jab after jab at religion and how it sort of forms over years of nonsense. But still, they're going to keep those character beats and show you sort of like what each of these characters will do. I just find is really interesting. When you do find out more information about the evolution of the cats.
Well, and that's not the only time that the show, you know, hits those points on religion. But, you know, again, you know, I think that third episode is a little weaker, but, you know, Waiting for God, that fourth episode, really is another sort of gut punch of an episode. And I think this isn't the only time where I have in my notes, like, this is Voltaire. This is, you know, Voltaire, you know, has that in, Candide, where you have these, you hear about these religious wars over the most stupid thing imaginable. You know, but it also sort of goes back to this kindness of Lister, as you said. That, like, you know, well, he's dying. What does it matter, right? I mean, if it is a meaningless universe, you know, enjoy your cat fantasy, right?
Yeah, that's it. He has some, you know, he will come across in different ways. Like I say, it comes up again later. But again, like I say, you're four episodes in to your first series of a sort of, let's say, a six episode sitcom. Yeah, this is an 80s BBC Two, so not even your prime BBC One. This is a BBC Two sitcom about, you know, some like the odd couple in space. And already, like you say, you've dealt with the potential a deterministic future, and, you know, the forming of religions that have sort of societies have structured themselves around. Four episodes in, and I'm just like, this is when you're a kid, though. It's still hilarious. Like, I'm still loving this show, but yeah, it's actually really, like you say, hitting those notes, isn't it, of really pushing the boundaries of what you can do and say with a daft space sitcom.
Oh, I agree. And again, like, that goes to the best of sort of what sci-fi can do, that these sci-fi setups can probe major concepts that ultimately, in searching for the other in outer space, we're searching for ourselves. And I think that Trek, you know, was able to deal with racism and things like that. Sexism, not so well. But Red Dwarf deals brilliantly with sexism, I think, in ways that that still flabbergast me. But I think that, you know, sort of the best of science fiction is able to address these things and get at something. And Red Dwarf is doing that, but it's doing that in this comedic context, which, I again, this is part of why this was so amazing to me, that it could be, not every episode is that deep about religion, but, you know, whether it's a presentation of a deterministic future that's very aggressive or whatever it's doing, it can have that weight, as you said, of sci-fi within this absurd context.
Yeah, and that's it. And it. So, you know, I mean, they're really sort of swinging for the fences. I mean, you know, if you're a Trek fan and you know, you would come across this, or even like a, you know, other, not say lesser, but things like, you know, Battlestar Galactica or other sci-fi shows of the time. You know, I mean, people are raving about things like the, you know, the Orville now. Like, you know, no,
right.
Like, Dwarf did it then. And they sort absolutely. Of, for me, they go out the end season series one on this sort of like double hitter that, again, like has this sort of like this bravery of, you know, when I watch it as a whole now, like I watch it with you know, probably with rose tinted glasses, and there are some things I will point out as we go along where it starts to not so much adhere to its own rules, but.
Mm-hmm.
I watch it as a whole. Like I watch it as Red Dwarf. But if you were to come at this as a sci-fi fan or as a comedy fan in 88, like, you know, you've had all these like these weird and weird, you know, episodes to begin with, and then the end, the last two, because it sort of plays almost as a weird two-parter. Just sort of like watching this one sort of really blew me away with how sort of they were sort of. Challenging these characters that you sort of think, okay, well, the first season we're going to play it a little bit safe, you know, we're going to sort of going to make sure that they rest the characters in, we're going to bed them in, we're going to try and sort of, you know, we want to end on a good note or whatever, but they literally end with this two episodes are called Confidence and Paranoia and then Me Squared, and the simple premise is, in Confidence and Paranoia, Lister gets an illness, a sort of space flu, they call it. It's quite sort of like space pneumonia. And he has all these hallucinations that then materialize in the real world. But one of them is this concept he has of his own sort of his own self, of his confidence being this sort of guy who's brash and loud and sort of like, he's all about your confidence, bigs you up all the time. And then you've got your paranoia, which is this little weedy person that's always going, yeah, but you're rubbish. You're not good enough. And why would anyone ever listen to you? And these two people materialize and then sort of like, you know, Dave Lister spends time with them and obviously starts leaning more and more into his confidence. And it's sort of, to me, you know, it plays out well that his confidence starts getting more and more ambitious and starts saying to him, why can't you do that? Of course you can do that. Figure this out. And at first it worked. And at the end of it, it's like, they say, you don't need to have a helmet on in space. You're the king. You're the man. Take it off. And it's hilarious. The guy who plays his confidence is brilliant. I fucking love him. I think he's hilarious. But it's this concept of like, if you actually start to lean into your own confidence, you need that little touch of paranoia to keep you grounded. Like, you know, it starts to lean into this idea of your confidence, too much confidence can be dangerous. And you're like, oh man, that's actually, you know, it's played out really well. And so you get this idea of, okay, then you've got to sort of like tailor yourself and you've got to sort of, you know, reflect on your own behaviors and how you interact with others and other. And then behind all this, the whole point is he's looking for the hollow disc for the hologram for Christine Kachansky, because they figured if they reduce the power of the rest of the ship, because no one else is using it, then they could support a second hologram. So he then finds it. And having had this whole thing about your confidence and your paranoia and having to face up to yourself, they then follow up with an episode where it isn't Christine Kachansky's disc he finds. He finds a copy of Rimmer's, puts it in, and you end up with two Rimmers.
Right.
And then you get Rimmer having to face up to himself in a fascinating finale in Me Squared. Of sort of, so you've had like Dave Lister face up to himself, and then Rimmer's having to do something similar, and it's just insane that they go into this level of sort of like psyche, you know, bashing for like the final two episodes of the first series of this little space sitcom.
Yeah, I never thought about how they were, that they're paired. Although obviously, you know, Me Squared continues from Confidence and Paranoia directly, which, you know, is not true of any of the other episodes of the first season. But, you know, I think you're completely correct. One of the things that fascinates me is the sort of depiction of both of these characters, that these episodes get at their psychology in a really probing way. And I think that, you know, like in Confidence and Paranoia, there's something really kind of, you know, despicable in Lister. It's partly this obsession over Kachansky, with whom, you know, he's spoken 140 some words, the computer says. And he's clearly just, he's fantasized about her. I mean, his whole plan for the future involves getting a stupid donut stand in Fiji with this woman who he hasn't bothered to talk to. And this, you know, while I think we can all relate to some degree to this depiction of sort of, I feel that confidence and then I go up to the girl and the paranoia sets in and, you know, you see her talking with somebody else or whatever, and it sort of throws you off and you think, oh yeah, she does not want to be talked to right now. I'm nothing here. But at the same time, there's something extreme. There's something in both of them that I find, especially in the wake of sort of the incel movement and sort of Me Too, you know, going back to, in Confidence and Paranoia, Rimmer says that he's part of a love celibacy movement, you know, and I thought, is that not incel, right? Like involuntary celibate, right? I mean, clearly, like, Rimmer, like, eschews love, right? I mean, but, so Rimmer is kind of like a misogynist in an open way. And later on, we see Lister, we see this play out in different ways. But Lister is, we'll say, women are people, just talk to them. But Lister also is a misogynist in his own way.
Yeah.
And is obsessing over this person who he doesn't know and is deeply, I mean, that's not well.
No. And I think his loneliness starts to play more and more into that, doesn't it? And that, you know, it's clear that even if this was sort of, I don't know, like a passing crush or, you know, something that wasn't, like you say, wasn't really in a good place to begin with, it clearly gets worse. You know, when he's facing up to a future of being stuck on a ship with Rimmer and the cat and Holly, like it's almost like, say, it's part and parcel of this, this, like say, this issue, that he is actually willing to sort of, like his confidence sort of come into it, but he just wants her hologram. Like she won't have a physical presence, but he just wants her around. And a part of me thinks like, why would you, like, you know, you're accepting that this is a godless universe in which you are 3 million years from into deep space, and there's not a great deal for you to do with the ship, and you want to put somebody else through that. That's incredibly selfish.
Oh yes. Well, that's kind of, you know, like, I mean, there was the movie Passengers where, you know, the male crew member wakes up one of the female crew members in suspended animation, and you know, that only came out recently, and boy, the sort of feminist criticism of that was incredibly strong. And I actually thought it was a fine movie, and I think intended to ask those questions and be disturbing and aware of all of those objections. And I think this is that same sort of idea of why would you condemn this person, but then, you know, you can understand how somebody would make that decision. And especially in this case, because you can always justify it as like, yeah, but it's a hologram, right? I mean, it's a computer process, which is another interesting thing that they fully treat Rimmer as a human being with no body, even though he's clearly a computer duplicate, right?
Yes. Yeah. And that's something that's interesting because, let's say, as you said, like, Rimmer evolves over time as a character. So, but Rumor's dead. Like, you know, that's sort of the thing. Like, the thing that the hologram that's brought back is a computer simulation of his own personality. And he admits that himself. So, you know, so how much of it is him growing? Like, he has all of Rumor's memories. He has all of his drives and his neuroses, like, clearly. So, you know, is it Rumor? So, you know, I suppose you can get to that thing of sort of, okay, so what differentiates him from that pile of white powder that was sat in the drive room after the accident? You know, it's still all him. It's still his personality.
In theory, right? Except there are moments again and again throughout the show where another crew member's personality sort of intrudes. So clearly, like, okay, this is some kind of personality disc, but however it's being played by Holly can screw up, right? So, I mean, there's no guarantee that, I mean, Holly has put, I mean, I don't mean to get all conspiratorial here, but I mean, Holly has put, has chosen Rumor to keep Lister sane. And says this, but we have no guarantee. I mean, except we've seen Rumor in real life for the first 20 minutes of the first episode, but other than that, I mean, we don't know what Holly's doing, right? I mean, Rumor, we assume, is pure and thus able to grow. But, I mean, I would not be surprised at all if they said, you know, this dim-witted computer has done something.
Now, that's a really good point. I've never thought of that. That actually sort of behind Rumor is Holly. I mean, you know, yeah, is how much intervention has there been? And is there, I mean, you say like he evolves, is that a natural evolution or is that, you know, involvement sort of like a external, forced evolution? I don't know. It's interesting actually, because the idea of the concept of the holograms is good. And it's never fully explored, from that thing. They talk about him having, you know, having to deal with his own death. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he does those things. Because he's able to give the other thing is he's able to give Holly instruction. Like he asks Holly to do things for him, so he has a sort of it's a computer simulation. It seems to be independent. Mm-hmm. Everything from, you know, having his teeth brushed to having his hair cut, and you know Holly is then able to do that thing. I mean, we'll get into an episode in the second series where you sort of find out that the computer actually can take over control of his body. Mm-hmm. So how much of it is Rumor, is it his mind, and how much is actually, like you say, a Holly doing whatever it is behind it?
Yeah, and I don't know that the show wants us to get all Philip K. Dick on it. No. I don't think this is necessarily intended, but it is, you know, a possible sort of conspiracy, you know, fan theory behind the scenes or something. But I mean, go ahead.
No, go on. No, I was just going to say, because you're right, because I mean, the last episode, that Me Squared, starts mm-hmm. to sort of throw that in, because although they are both Rumor, they appear to be Rumors from slightly different. They are slightly different. You know what I mean? There's the Rumor that's lived through the isolation for a period of time, and then the Rumor that hasn't, I think, really. The Rumor, there's one Rumor that seems to have accepted it and is a bit, you know, does want to sort of go to sleep and not too worried about revision. Then there's another one that seems to keep driving him. He's like, no, through the pain barrier, when they're doing like star jumps, aren't they? It's going grey. And then he's like, well, we can get a couple of hours of revision and we can do this. And that feels like the Rumor that you met in episode one.
Right.
You know, more so than the Rumor that you've got to know over the last couple of episodes. And so, yeah, it's that difference, even a little bit of time. But like you say, having to live with yourself seems horrific in that episode.
Yeah, in that episode. But, I mean, I would find it fascinating. But, you know, it sort of starts well. And then, of course, given his personality, Rimmer's going to, you know, start complaining and blaming each other. And, you know, it really goes... It really gets pretty dark.
Yeah. Some of the things they say to each other and start blaming each other for, and then sort of the arguments sprout out.
Well, at one point, one of them, you know, yells out from his quarters, you know, like, you know, shut up, you distended rectum. So vicious. They're so vicious to each other, which of course is also a manifestation of how vicious Rimmer is to himself, right?
Yeah, I suppose it is. It comes down to that sort of level of self-loathing, isn't it? That sort of initially the idea of being able to live with himself and, you know, able to sort of like encourage himself and give himself that extra boost all the time. But yeah, eventually it sort of just becomes his own self-loathing that takes over again and starts to push him, you know, push him down that, like you say, that dark track. Go on.
Well, this episode also suggests, I mean, there's the whole like gazpacho soup thing, right? Which is kind of like a Citizen Kane reference, you know, it's a joke. But I mean, this episode postulates, I mean, at least Rimmer believes, that what ruined his career was not knowing gazpacho soup is cold, right? And so, I mean, he says, like, I mean, I think we can all relate to the obvious haunting embarrassment that he has. But this idea that, you know, my life came down to this one moment in which I embarrassed myself, which of course is absurd to some degree. I mean, he may well be rationalizing, but he may not. And, you know, he even says, like, you know, this ruined my career. And you know, if only the gazpacho soup had been taught at the academy, you know, which is very funny. But then there's also this sort of like, well, this idea of, it's who you know, right? It's the networking. And that's impressive. And Rimmer is horrible at networking, right? Nobody is ever going to meet Rimmer and say, that's the guy I want to give a job to.
Yeah. And I think, even in the episode, like you say, you find out what a bit of a pillock he is in that respect. Because at the end of it, it boils down to the two Rimmers. One has to be deleted and they have I forget, it's a competition in some way to decide who's going to be deleted. And the winner is actually the second Rimmer actually wins. So the original Rimmer turns up to the drive room ready to be deleted, wearing a full dress uniform with three medals on.
Yeah.
And it shows, I say, the jobs worth of it, that he's wearing that. And you find out it's his 5 years, was it? It's his 3 year long service, his 6 year long service, his 9 year long service medals.
I think there's a 12 too.
It was a 12-year. Yeah, so, yeah,
those are the only commendations he's ever won.
Yeah, but again, like, it just shows that thing, doesn't it? That sort of like he's the kind of person that he is willing to do that. It shows why when he turns up into a room, everyone just goes, "Oh God, it's him." You know, and so even to the last, he can't get away from himself.
Now he's not really deleted at the end, even though we never see him again, right? I mean, Lister says like, no, this was just a threat to kind of get you to confess.
They'd already deleted the other one because Lister had just decided. So he actually says, he gets him to tell the story, the gazpacho soup story. And then he says, right, well, I'm ready. And he says, oh, we've already deleted the other one before you came in.
Okay.
It was just a trick just to get you to tell the story. But more than that, to tell you this story and then have to live with the fact that you've told us this story. So even Lister could be a bit mean at times.
Oh, right. I mean, he's definitely manipulative. I mean, in terms of just sort of stray thoughts wrapping up the first season, you know, one is confidence is depicted as so American, right? I mean, this sort of like Italian-American sort of stereotype. And that sort of comes back later when we meet Ace Rimmer, although he's kind of like borrowed from Dan Dare stuff. I mean, am I wrong in thinking, like, you know, when the depiction of a sort of brashly confident person seems like an American depiction?
Oh, no, that it's totally. I mean, I love the fact that they actually say, like, he's the combination of two things. I think it's sort of like what the owner of Dave Lister's favorite sports team, Zero G football team, is, and the personality of the game show host that he admired as well. So it's like you say, it's this very sort of like, he wears like a bright yellow check suit with a sort of like, say, the shirt across the waist with the medallion and all that sort of thing. Like, he is it's a very American sort of secondhand car salesman, isn't it, sort of thing. It's all sort of like brash and loud and he is, Because then again, but then I said the opposite of that. The paranoia is incredibly British. He's a very sort of like, you know, he's a British actor. I know from a lot of other things, but he's, you know, he's thin, he's weedy, he's very pale. He's got sort of like, you know, very black hair and sort of like, it goes back to that sort of thing we said before about the British cynicism of sort of, you know, those characters are like Basil Fawlty and all that. That paranoia is. So, you know, we joke about it being American, but actually the aspirational conference is that you know, that Americans, that the American thing is what he looks up to. So, yeah, he is very American, but I wouldn't say it was a bad thing though,
right?
In that respect,
right.
Or at least not today.
Well, you know, I mean, the American, you need an American to be so confident that he takes off his helmet and explodes, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I had a few stray thoughts. One was that, you know, in the Future Echoes, it occurred to me only much later that in Future Echoes, Lister is debating whether to go into stasis, right? And, you know, he says, well, it's going to take 3 million years to go back to Earth. I should just go into stasis again for another 3 million years. And then, you know, I'll get to see Earth because I'm going to die alone in space with a stupid hologram. I'm not sure. They just kind of drop that. I'm not sure why he doesn't go into stasis.
No, it's never picked up again. It's never sort of, and you know, you could even have like a drop line at the end of an episode or something of like, oh, the status pods are all broken, irreparable, like 3 million years worth of damage or something. Like, yeah, they could have, but it never comes up again.
Right. Yeah, and you know, Holly can only sustain this one hologram. You know. You know, I mean, there's just little nitpicky stuff that occurs to me. I don't care at all because I'm sold by the show. I mean, it just works so much.
Yeah, I have to say, sort of like they try to sustain the hologram thing throughout the first season relatively well. The idea of sustaining a single hologram, because they do set up for Me Squared, like, oh, we're going to shut down vast portions of the ship and all this other stuff, like non-essentials. And all right, I could sort of buy that. It changes a little bit later. Even in series two, it starts to sort of, I have questions about the use of a hologram.
Yeah.
but we'll get to that in a minute.
What about the one thing we haven't mentioned is, you know, although they didn't want to use androids in the first season, there are a bunch of robots that are characters. And I had kind of forgotten how much the Scudders, these two sort of unspeaking robots, how funny they are and how they sort of evolve over the course of the early seasons. One of the first things is, I forget what I think Lister's talking to them and they're suicidal and they sort of pound their heads into the wall. You know, they're always doing these wonderfully absurd sort of things. They watch movies alone, you later see. I find the Scudders really charming.
They are great. I like, yeah, because you find out the sort of Rimmer catches them in the cinema, doesn't he? And they pretend to be working. They hold up a dustpan and brush.
Yeah.
And later on, like you say, you find out that I think it's in series two. It's in Better Than Life. There's a parcel that's from I think it's like the John Wayne appreciation or the John Wayne fan club, and you find actually that they're fans of westerns as well. it's them that's requested that. Yeah, the Scudders are great. They sort of they have a great personality, and they get less used as things go on, but they have some fantastic moments. Even in Confident Paranoia, when sort of you do sort of they allude to sort of like some of the simple things that you know, Lister hasn't got a body. The cat doesn't really care about what's going on the great deal of the time. So when Lister's ill, the only things that can take care of him are the Scudders.
Oh yeah, right.
And so they try to take his temperature, but end up sort of poking him in the eye with a with a thermometer.
What's really funny there is Rimmer's, you know, beside him and says, you know, now they have to learn. You know, like, yeah, there's no feeling at all for Lister. Rimmer's right there saying, like, we're gonna teach these Scudders to administer, you know, he jokes about a rectal examination with a rectal temperature taking. You know, but the idea of like the training those Scudders is more important than your pain when you're sick.
There's a great moment later on when they sort of, in one of the future scenes, I can't remember which it is, when they just say, he says about the Scutters, he says he's going to ask them to do something. He says, if you can't ask them to do that, he says, well, no, we haven't got a choice. He's like, look, he said, they're the kind of people that you said, if you ask, you know, watch that cake whilst it's cooking, they will sit and they will watch that cake burn, like, because they can't think beyond that instruction. And I just love that they, but they do keep coming up as little characters. I think they're so funny.
And it's such great, sort of like grace notes in that first season, you know.
Yeah, and I think one of the things sort of that we haven't really touched on, we sort of mentioned, is actually, you know, one of the reasons I think this works so well is the cast.
Mm-hmm.
They sort of just hit the you know, you say about the race notes and stuff, like they hit the floor running. And you do have quite a diverse cast. And the fact of the matter is, the most unlikable character in this is the sort of, you know, if you were to look at this from today's sort of modern, you know, diversity window sort of thing, like, they have got this thing of, like, the most unlikable character in this is the sort of, like, the standard sort of wanting to be middle class white guy.
Yes.
You know?
Absolutely.
And, you know, then sort of, like, Dave Lister, played by Craig Charles, is mixed race, and I think it's half caste, I know, but, you know, mixed race, but he, you know, he's sort of playing, and also he's a strong Liverpudlian, so he's got a Scouse accent, sort of, you know, a relative sort of northern accent, and then on that you get Danny John Jules playing the cat, you know, in the best possible way, as a full-on sort of like crazed narcissist, and he's so wonderful at it. Like, I think each of them in this, and Norman Lovett as well as the computer, as Holly, they just seem to get their characters quite quickly. You know, they just sort of seem to settle into them. I don't think they get the credit they deserve really for doing what they do in the first series.
Oh yeah, I agree, and I think that I like that diversity. I am sometimes bothered by the black character being cast, or the black actor being cast as, like, you know, the guy who loves to dance, you know?
Yeah.
But I love the fact that nobody ever remarks on Lister not being white. You know, it's not an issue, or being mixed. I mean, this is not an issue. Even Rimmer, who's despicable, doesn't bring this up, right?
Yeah, well, that's it. Like I say, race is never in it. And, you know, it's that sort of, like you say, you go to the sort of that Trek future, the Roddenberry future. Like, you know, race is really not an issue in this thing. And you know, when we get to sort of season two and you get the introduction of Crichton as well, it's sort of like, even not being human, I suppose with the cat, like, doesn't matter. Like, you know, we're just there for each other if we can, even if we don't really like each other. I think sort of like, you know, one of the weird things about this is sort of like when they first met, Craig Charles and Chris Barry, like, didn't really get along.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there was actually some concern within the first series that, you know, it wouldn't work between them. Maybe that sort of worked on the screen, that sort of brought the right chemistry.
Yeah.
But you know, it's interesting to see how it sort of played out in sort of real life a little bit as well. But the one thing you say about the cat, is from what I understand, like, they weren't really sure what they wanted for that character. They'd had this sort of idea of it being like this evolved cat, and apparently they auditioned a number of people. And Danny John Jules is a dancer by tradition. You know, by that was actually his job. He was sort of coming on as it, sort of trying to be an actor, but was came from a dancing background. And he actually turned up and just basically did what you see. That sort of, like, you know, goes, and sort of, like, shuffles around, did all that kind of stuff, and they were like, that is the cat, that is perfect, like, you know, it's spot on. And so I you know, I like the fact that sort of in many of the episodes, like, he's not particularly involved in the main plot. He's like a little side character, and he has his own little moments, because, you know, like when in Confidence and Paranoia, when sort of Rimmer rushes in because he's sort of, you know, when Lister's ill, and he's like, you know, he's like, Lister's sick, you've got to come and help. And he's like, oh, that's a shame, I'm eating lunch. And it takes him sort of like several minutes to come up and help. And in fact, I don't think he does, actually. I think it's, like I say, the Scutters have to come and help, isn't it?
Yeah, and
In fact, he pretends to get up several times, and Rimmer keeps coming back, and the cat goes, oh, you know, and gets up, and finally Rimmer comes back and says, you know, now, you know, ask yourself, Lister's lying there, unconscious, clearly ill, you know, and you are eating. You know, which of these things do you think is more important? And the cat says, like, I can't believe you we would even ask that. Of course, you know.
But I like the fact that within that moment, like, you know, the cat and Lister become quite good friends. And everything. We always rip on Rimmer. But the fact of the matter is, Rimmer is rushing around looking to help a very sick Dave Lister, and it's actually the cat that's like, no, I'm busy. I've got the lunch, and then I'm scheduled for a nap. Actually, taking the conspiratorial sort of sense that maybe is how much is Holly behind it. It does go to show that actually, like, Rimmer does have a side of, like, he is looking to look after, Lister. So there's little moments like that I do really appreciate.
Yeah, that had never occurred to me. But you're absolutely right. I mean, taken objectively, that cat is a much worse person, right? I mean, clearly he is a total narcissist in a way that that Rimmer's not. You know, Rimmer is obviously self-obsessed, has a Napoleon complex, quite literally, admires Napoleon, and this is always a running joke. But the cat, you know, and I think that partially he's supposed to be an evolved cat, right? So we sort of give him an excuse. But also I think he steals the show in every scene he's in, especially in the first couple seasons. And he's just so charming. He's the devilish character who you just find charming so much so that you don't even notice. Like, yeah, of course he's a total narcissist. He just seems honest. Like, well, yeah, I'm eating food right now. Right now, this is the most important thing to me. It's not that I don't care about Lister, but I'm eating right now. How do you not get that? You do you, man.
He becomes slightly more self-aware as the seasons progress. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid I'm going to have to be an annoying little smegger and cut in right there. These episodes have been so big that we're actually going to have to cut in and have them released on a weekly schedule. So don't you worry, there will be more Red Dwarf epic analysis from myself and Julian. We'll be back next week talking Series 2, and then beyond that, the rest of the franchise. We are going to be talking about all of the series, the American pilots. We're going to mention the magazines, the novels, everything you can think of. So sit back and relax and wait, and I'll see you next week. But in the meantime, if you want to come back and you want to talk to Julian or I about Red Dwarf or about any of our shows, come find us on Twitter at PodTimeSpace. We love to talk to our fans, so please reach out. And we'll see you next week. Same dwarf time, same dwarf channel.